अच्छा अच्छा ये था सर, दिल वाला था, दूसरों की मदद करने वाला था।
On October 8, police in Karnataka arrested 10 people alleged to have conspired and killed Arbaaz, a 24-year-old Muslim man who was in a relationship with a Hindu woman. The Hindu woman's parents were among those arrested in the case. By now, many of you have heard about this incident. But what does this incident mean for all of us who live in Karnataka and call it our home? Why did this happen? And how did we get here? We have been reporting about this case from day one. And we have also been reporting about the larger polarization in Karnataka for the last few years. And we may have some answers for you. But before I get into that, a quick reminder for you to support our journalism. Only with your support can we do stories like this. So click the link in the description to become a member of the News Minute community and also subscribe to our YouTube channel if you haven't already. Now for a recap. From what we know, Arbaaz and the Hindu woman were in a relationship for nearly 3 years. They knew each other having lived in the same locality in Khanapur, a town in Belagavi district of Karnataka. They loved each other and they were in a mutually consenting relationship. We know this because Arbaaz's sister was in touch with the Hindu woman even after Arbaaz's death. We know all this from the many selfies, pictures, videos, WhatsApp and Instagram chats between Arbaaz and the Hindu woman. But the love and affection between them was no match for the hate that has been whipped up in the region for the last several years. Arbaaz's parents and the Hindu woman's parents were against his relationship. They repeatedly urged the couple to break off their relationship, partly due to the communal polarization this region has seen. The couple refused and resisted for a long time, and this is when Hindu fringe groups stepped in. We are not sure when the Hindu fringe group Sri Ram Sena Hindustan first contacted Arbaaz, but by September 2021, Arbaaz's mother Nazima got to know that Arbaaz was being threatened and blackmailed by fanatics part of this group. Now, they didn't just have a political and communal agenda. They were using hatred against Muslims as a way to make money. They were extortionists who asked for money, according to the police. Two members of Sri Ram Sena Hindustan, Pundalik and Prashant, met Arbaaz and his mother at the Khanapur Chowk on 26 September. In this meeting, they pressurized Arbaaz into ending his relationship. And more importantly, they asked him to pay a settlement amount. Arbaaz paid them Rs 7,000 on the day and also paid them Rs 75,000 2 days later, the day he was found brutally murdered. So according to the police, it was not just the Muslim family that was being asked to pay. The Hindu woman's parents were also asked to pay an amount. The police say that this amount was close to Rs 5 lakh and of this, Rs 60,000 was already paid in advance. Now here's another interesting thing. The Sri Ram Sena Hindustan had laid down a condition. They told the parents that if the murder angle ever came out in this case, that they would surrender themselves to the police. So that is why when the police suspected murder, the parents came forward to surrender themselves. So yes, they would make money off both sides, kill a man, destroy an interfaith relationship and still remain protected by dumping all the blame on the parents. That was their plan. But thankfully, the police in this case saw through the parents' version and arrested Pundalik and several others from the Sri Ram Sena Hindustan. The larger point here is that this criminal and risk-free model of communal hate in Karnataka is not new. We did not get here overnight. Now this is a broad plan. Whip up hate, indulge in violence based on that hate, and then leverage that violence for political and financial gains. To understand why such a brazen, communal and criminal enterprise exists in Karnataka, we must first understand the story of this man. Most of us heard of Pramod Muttalik when this happened. The Mangalore pub attack of 2009. This is when the group Sri Ram Sena, started by Pramod Muttalik, shot to fame. Now, many Hindutva groups have been active in this coastal Karnataka region, but the emergence of Pramod Muttalik, Sri Ram Sena, revitalized these groups on ground. Since then, many organizations linked to Pramod Muttalik have been active not only in areas like Mangaluru and Udupi, but also in the North Karnataka areas of Belagavi, Dharwad, and Kalaburgi. The politics of these groups extended to cold-blooded murders. A series of murders in the North Karnataka region and its nearby areas brought this to light. In 2013, rationalist Narendra Dabolkar was killed in Pune. In 2015, CPIM leader Govind Pansare was similarly killed in Kolhapur, which neighbours Karnataka. The same year, right here in North Karnataka, M.M. Kalburgi was killed. All these murders were linked to the Sri Ram Sena and other Hindutva organisations, including the Hindu terror outfit Sanatan Sanstha. In fact, the man who shot Gauri Lankesh dead in Bengaluru in 2017 was from the Shriram Sene, and he received arms training in Khanapur, the hometown of Arbaaz. Like we saw in the Arbaaz case, Hindutva for these groups is not just about politics and social control. It is also about money. The journalist Dhirendra Jha has previously reported how Hindutva groups have run protection rackets in Mangaluru. They intimidated malls and businesses into giving them security contracts. What's even more shocking is the fact that Ramakant Kunduzkar, who heads the Shriram Sena Hindustan in Belagavi, has openly admitted that his organization has worked with the police department to stop many Hindu women from marrying outside their community. So it's no surprise that in the last few years, political gains have been reaped by those who follow the Hindutva ideology, directly or indirectly. The seeds of hate sown by Muttalik and his men have now grown into a massive tree in Karnataka. And this is why Arbaaz's girlfriend's parents, who were just another regular family, saw murder as an accessible option when they saw their daughter involved in an interfaith relationship. This is why there was no opposition or protest in the region when the violence occurred. This is why there was no civil society activism or open political pushback when this happened. And this is why Arbaaz will probably not be the last Muslim man of his kind. And the Hindu woman's parents will not be the last ones to be exploited and jailed. What we need to understand from what's happening in Karnataka today is that this hatred costs all of us, Hindus and Muslims. And the beneficiaries are a select few who want to grab money and power. The support for this kind of hate politics is feeding a criminal enterprise. And this will not stop until the ideological foundation for this enterprise is countered.